Lovely to be here today. I am going to talk about OER essentials, and what we're going to do today is really kind of focus on four key issues. Some of you will be very familiar with all these four issues, some of you won't be as familiar with all of these issues, but what I thought we could have is a little bit of space today to reflect on our own practice, to reflect on our colleagues' practice and our students' practice, and think about whether we want to change what we're currently doing when we go forward, or whether we actually need to tell more people about the great stuff that we're already doing. So can I have a quick hands up for everybody in the room who's from Coventry? Okay, that's great. Can I have a quick hands up in the room from everybody who has used an openly licensed resource, an OER? Somebody who's found and used an OER? That's great. And can I have a quick hands up from everybody in the room who's created and shared an openly licensed resource? Fantastic. Well, that's a perfect mix for today's talk, so big relief for me. Okay, so first of all, just to kind of frame the project a little bit and to frame the work that I'm going to be talking about today and the resources that I'm going to share to you, with you today, which are themselves open educational resources. So if you've never used an OER before today, when you leave this session, you will have done. Okay, so we're through that gateway for you, that dangerous gateway. The project comes from some work that I've been doing in Leicester with secondary school, special education and specialist provision schools, looking at staff and how school staff use technology to support learning, teaching and community development. All the things that you guys are very interested in this context. And to look at that, what we've been doing is working with those staff members to understand what digital literacy means to them and what digital literacy means in practice. So not an abstract notion of digital literacy is a great thing, we all need to get on a note, but actually, what does it mean to me in terms of the things that I do in my work with my learners? And from that, we surveyed our staff. Last year, we had 701 staff took time out to complete a rather lengthy survey. We did try and keep it as short as possible, but we were very, very grateful for them to give us their time. And what we found out is a citywide picture of strengths and gaps in knowledge and confidence around different types of digital literacy practice. These are two of the areas out of the six areas that we looked at. Finding, evaluating and organising, which is fairly self-explanatory, I'd hope, in terms of what it means to digital resources. And also creating and sharing. Now, these two things are things that school staff do every single day. They have to do it as part of their process. And, you know, we all recognise wherever parts of the education system or sector that we're in now, that using digital resources, finding digital resources and creating digital resources are part of our mainstream practice today. So they all do these things. So we would have expected these two scores to be quite high and we would have expected quite a lot of staff confidence in these areas. However, they were lower than we imagined they were going to come out as. And digging a bit more deeply into that, we found out that one of the reasons was confidence around copyright issues. And in particular, understanding of copyright as it relates to different kinds of licensing, like open licensing, and as it relates to things like knowing about, being able to access and use open educational resources. Now, there's a huge wealth of material in that area, and I know that you've talked this morning already about the kind of extent of that, and I know many of you will be really, really aware of how huge the numbers of resources and the numbers of projects looking at this area actually are on an international scale. But if we have staff who have never heard of open educational resources, who've never heard of Creative Commons, which is one of the licenses that I'm going to sets that I'm going to talk about today, which is probably the most famous open educational resource, then you can't access those. You can't take those first steps into engaging and using and getting value out of those resources. So in response to that, we've been doing a bunch of stuff that I'm going to talk through a little bit during this talk. But the first and one of the most important things we've done is we've created this guidance for schools. What we did is we drew on openly licensed resources from around the web. We created also original content, and we've created a four-part guidance document that really covers the basic things and covers the four things that I'm going to be talking about today, which are: what is an openly licensed resource? What is an open license? How do I find openly licensed resources? And how do I make and share openly licensed resources? Okay, so there's the page on the web, and I will tweet the link as well. This is Leicester City Council Schools Extranet page. It's open for all of our schools. Usually, a lot of it's closed off in terms of the content. You have to be a teacher in Leicester to be able to access this. This page is open for anyone in the world to come and get our resources, and there's guidance and other resources on that page. Now, if you are a person who's slightly insecure in themselves, which many of us are, there's no judgment there, you might not want to be seen reading a school document. You might feel a bit funny about it for some reason. So luckily for you, our great friends at Durham have actually created a HENFE version of this guidance. They've built on it, they've developed it, so you can go to the Durham website and you can download a version that has FE and HE in there instead of schools, and they've gone through that text and made it especially for you guys. So do go down and find that. Okay, so the first part of the guidance, the first document, is around open education and the school sector. And it asks, what are open educational resources? Anybody from the audience want to answer? Unfair. Okay, so there's lots of different definitions of open educational resources out there. This is the resource, this is the definition that we use in this document. So it's important to know this isn't set in stone, this isn't cast in stone, but this is typical of the types of definition that you will see about what an open educational resource is. And they tend to boil down to, one, they're free. And I know that we've covered already this morning the difference between free and open in some of the conversations, but they do tend to be free. They're also learning resources in some way. And a learning resource can be a multitude of things. It could be a video. It could be a set of lesson plans. It could be a course outline. It could be revision materials. It could be an e-textbook. It could be an audio file. A huge, huge amount of work can be educational resources. It's an educational resource that has had an open license applied to it or is in the public domain. So public domain items are obviously free for everybody to use and make use of and remix and do other things with. Other than that, in that section, you'd have to have an open license attached to it somewhere to signal. And partly why you have to have an open license attached to it is that the default copyright laws will kick in if you're not signalling clearly that that's an openly licensed resource. So if I see a resource online that hasn't got any kind of indication that I can use it, the assumption that I should make is that's copyrighted by someone, and if I want to use it in my work, if I want to use it with my learners, I need to get in touch with that person and get permission from that person if there's not an easier way to see that they've given me permission. So that's the definition that we've got in the documentation, and that just covers the resources and looks at formats. And that's just a quick statement from UNESCO, really. That's just to reiterate to you guys that open educational resources are an international issue. And it's an issue about educational equality. It's an issue about educational access for all. And as such, it's an important area for educators to know about, to understand, and hopefully to also contribute to as well. This is the diagram that we use in the first guidance to talk about what makes up an OER. And why this is important is because attaching an open license to an educational resource provides a legal freedom. What it does is it says, this resource is legally free for you to use. However, that's not the only kind of consideration that we need to think about when we're creating resources ourselves. The other kinds of things that we need to think about are things like accessibility. And that's in its broadest sense. Are these resources accessible for people with learning difficulties, for example? Have we taken basic checks and steps to make sure that people with learning resources might be able to access them? And that's also an issue around file formats and types as well. If I release my open educational resource in a programme that costs £60 million for you to open, well, very few people will be able to access that freely and use that freely. If I release my open educational resource only in PDF format, then somebody, but give permission for people to build on and change that work, then whoever gets that is going to have a difficult time taking that work and remaking and remixing it. And on our page, we've released everything in PDF form, but because it's quite nice for printing, but we've also included versions of our documents that are editable. And we've included all of the kind of assets around the icons and the pictures that we've used as well, so people can remix and match their own versions of those documents quite easily. Okay, so the second document that we've got in the pack is around understanding open licensing. And an open license is a signal, really. It's a signal that builds on top of the existing copyright regulations and framework and gives permission for you to use my work or the work of the person that's attached that license in specific ways. And in return for you using that work in specific ways, it will ask certain things. And there's one thing that open licenses typically ask, so not public domain licenses, but open licenses, they always ask, you must accredit this work. So you must say, who's created this work, where you've got it from, and typically what license it's released under as well. But that's all you have to do. That's the price of using those resources, of building on those resources. But actually, it's hugely beneficial for us as individuals, for us as organisations, to know that our work is being shared and our efforts are being appreciated and credited back too. So it's a very powerful thing, I think, in terms of your own professional practice, your own professional development, and also in terms of your organisational development and reputation. So what does an openly licensed resource look like? Because some of you in this room will never have will have seen openly licensed resources, but may not have recognised them as that. So you can see from the document that we've got here, this is a document with an open license on it, and you can see that it's got one of the Creative Commons licenses attached to it. It has two little icons. The CC means Creative Commons, so you can immediately see that's a Creative Commons license set. You know that already. And then the little symbols say various things, and we're going to look at that in a second. Also, you usually typically will have a credit line next to it, as you do in this document as well. That's for this kind of document. So if I'm making, for example, an audio file, I might not have anywhere to put my logo on. What I might do instead is speak to the audio file and say, this audio recording is licensed under this kind of license, 2015, thank you very much. Or I might be able to put my license adjacent to the things that I'm sharing. So, for example, if I'm using images, I might not want to have a license on my image. I might have an indication. So there's lots of different ways that you can show that things are openly licensed, so you can see if you're openly licensed. And why they're important, as I said before, is because they send a clear message. I don't have to find out where you live, go around your house and say, you know that picture, I really like it. I'd love to put that in my presentation. Can I have permission to put it in my presentation, please? Because that permission is given upfront, transparently, and I know what permissions you have and haven't given me. For those people who do like going around people's houses or emailing them and asking them for further permissions, also remember licenses aren't set in stone. You might come across a license that is restricts you from, for example, remixing or developing a resource, but you might really, really want to, you can still get in touch with that person and ask for permission. It doesn't stop you from carrying on and asking for further permissions. And people can say yes or they can say no. Okay, so we're going to do a quick exercise now. These are the Creative Commons licenses down this side. That's the public domain, that's a public domain mark, the Creative Commons public domain mark as well. What I want you to do is you've all got sheets near your packs that go through the different license types and give you some information about those different licenses. So you've got 5 minutes now I want you to talk to the person next to you. Try and find somebody who, if you know lots and lots about Creative Commons licenses, try and find somebody who doesn't know so much. I want you to look at, I want you to pick which license is your favourite. Okay? You've got 5 minutes. You've got 5 minutes, and then I'm going, then we're going to have a vote, and I'm going to ask you why that's your favourite. How am I doing for time?
But I think that it's not the sort of thing, it's just that sort of thing that things that actually benefits the world in some ways. And one of the things I do feel when we talk about, well, it's general good, all these things, of course, the overall move, maybe now the fight happens out, certainly it's been over the last 15 years, it's been aggressively the other way around. Narrowing things down, sometimes very, very steeply in many ways. So it makes sense. I think it's really good that this is almost the idea of the thing which goes against that. But it is interesting, he said, but I always sort of, and I've got, no, loads of, I've done one other work for you, I did a project which was about open innovation, we played the social open innovation network thing, open innovation, that was actually a last year, sort of major project. I had a bit of an argument with them. We had some of our commercial people who were really stuck. And I was saying, well, actually, what you're doing is that you're introducing commercial elements. This is true, we're talking about innovation.
Okay, so we've had a bit of time to have a think and a talk about the different kinds of licenses, and hopefully you've explored some of the things that you might not have known about before. Obviously, you've got very small definitions on about the licenses in there. Yes, and it's a rude introduction in many ways to the Creative Commons licenses. But you can go online, there's lots and lots of information and walkthroughs and lots of advice and guidance around what those different licenses mean. And typically as well, what we try to do is link back the license that we use or the license that somebody else has used to the license information page that's up as well, which gives you the kind of full details of that. So in the electronic version of the guidance, for example, if you click on where it says CC BY, it will take you through to the Creative Commons page on what that license means as well. So you can be extra clear what the conditions attached to those resources are that you're attaching or that somebody else is asking you to look at. Okay, so let's start with attribution, CC BY. Hands up if this was your favourite licence. Okay, so we've got one, two. There's no half-heartedness about this. You're either with it or you're not with it. You need to commit at this point. Obviously, life is a long journey. At some point, you may reflect and change, and that's perfectly fine as well. But here and now, let's get you committed to something. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so we've got 8 for that one. Okay, attribution share alike license. Who loves this one? Love, obviously, being mainly a bit of a strong word in this context, but who likes this one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Let's move on to no derivatives. So you can have my stuff, you can share my stuff, but you can't touch my stuff. You have to leave it as it is. Okay? So whose favourite is this one? Anybody in the room? Oh, you're all interested, obviously, in being able to make other people's work that little bit better. Yeah. That's great. Unpopular today. Okay, so attribution non-commercial. You can do what you like with my stuff, but you cannot sell it and you cannot use it in a commercial context. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. Any more? 5, 4, okay. Again, this isn't like the most rigorous research process we could do for this. It's a bit of a straw poll. Okay, and public domain. So who wants to just abandon their rights recklessly and say, you know what, you have my stuff, you don't have to say anything about who's created it, you can do whatever you like with it, I don't want any credit for the work. Just go ahead. Enjoy. Okay, 1, 2. They're the hardcore corner. Over there, we've got the hardcore corner. Okay, so from that, what we've got is CC BY as the clear winner. So round of applause to CC BY on this occasion. Yeah, but I'm... Oh, right, okay. You see, the thing is my idea was to do the kind of least complicated ones and then to go into others. All right, so hands up if you want to vote for anything we haven't mentioned yet or some other license. So Creative Commons is not the only form of open license. There's, for example, the Open Government license, which is an equivalent type of license. So hands up for something that isn't on the list. Either one of the ones that we've not looked at. So either attribution, commercial, share alike, or non-derivatives, or a license that's another license. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, so that then changes the picture in the room quite considerably. Okay, I want to ask somebody who has voted for CC BY one reason why they voted for CC BY. Have we got any takers? There we go. There's a brave lady over there. Is the mic on?
I think it's my responsibility as a researcher, as someone who works in the educational domain as an educator, to contribute to the breadth of knowledge that we have in whatever way possible. And to me, that means acknowledging that other people will be able to develop on my work and improve things.
And do you have any qualms? So quite a few people in the room looked at the non-commercial aspect of the license. Mm-hmm. Do you have any qualms about that kind of area?
I do have some concerns about that, and I reserve the right to change my mind to the non-commercial.
Okay, you cannot... Right, one of the things about Creative Commons licences rather than government licences is that they're you can't take back the rights once you've given them. So once I've put that licence on my work, that's the licence that stands on my work.
Yeah.
I can reissue my work with a different licence, but that version stands and people can still do what they want. So you can't sneak in later on.
No, I mean, don't change the licence on the work, but change my mind about the licences as I continue working. But no, for now, I'm happy to use that licence still.
Okay. Fantastic. Okay, can I ask somebody who was in the another camp? Helen, can you tell us which licence you've picked and why?
Huge amounts of love for number 5, attribution, non-commercial, share alike. That's the one that I use. And the reason being that if somebody wants to use my work in some way, I do expect to have attribution.
Yes.
I don't want somebody to make money from my work. But I think share alike for me is incredibly important. For me, ideologically, that's kind of the lifeblood of the internet. You know, it's about networked creativity, and that to me kind of sums it up. So that is the reason why I love number 5 with all of my heart.
Okay. And what about other commercial contexts? So for example, some of you might know TES, which is one of the biggest repositories of staff, a school staff resources, recently introduced open licensing. And if you upload a resource to that site now, you have to apply a Creative Commons license. But you don't apply a non-commercial license because obviously TES, although they're not making money from hosting those resources, they are in the background.
Yeah, I deal with that on a case-by-case basis. Okay. And the reason I go for the non-commercial is because there are so many examples of companies like Virgin or Nokia who have just taken somebody's photo of their kids off the internet and plastered it all over buses because it was just openly licensed and then kind of got away with it. But I have, in the past, allowed people to use images for their works, which have been commercial works, so kind of the cover of a knitting book and a hip-hop magazine. And because what this does is people generally tend to send you an email and say, can we use your thing? And you rarely say no. They'll usually just send you a copy and say, oh, we'll send you. You know, that's fine. Yeah. It's about goodwill, I think.
What about the university context? Is the university a non-commercial context? If I'm a lecturer at Aberdeen and I've seen your amazing resource and I want to use it with my undergraduate class, is that a commercial context or not? Would I be able, in the terms of the conditions of that licence, to use it or not?
I don't see that as being a commercial context within the public university system, even though increasingly they are being
run. Is that
run.
Because it's education?
It's because it's education, yeah, with a big E.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think the important part, thank you ever so much for taking part in that. Has anybody got any burning things that they want to say in terms of licences before we move on? Please.
Just one point. Why I think is difficult, because I voted with my heart, we were talking about this, is number five.
Yeah.
But actually, one of the strong arguments for even going to the top attribution is that if one looks at it in terms of practice, and this is particularly the case with software, some of the biggest donators to open source software are commercial companies. Now, they gain out of it, but you can also say, and there's no question about this, an example, for instance, is Apache software, which runs pretty well, you know, all the servers in the world in one form or another, that actually then benefits the wider community. But you wouldn't get that involvement by commercial companies inputting into it unless they could take something out which they could just use commercially. So there are sort of pros and cons, you know, whatever one believes, really.
Yeah, and I think what you're pointing out is that it's actually a very... We live in a capitalist society. It's quite a complex situation in terms of what's commercial and what's not commercial, and teasing that out. Really, I'm not here to say to you, you need to do this, you need to use this licence. Now, I've made a recommendation at Leicester City Council on behalf of Leicester City Council, and I stand by my recommendation. We'll talk about that in a bit. But I think a really, really important thing for educational communities is to think about those terms and conditions, have conversations about why they prefer certain licences to other licences, and actually engage in those discussions. Now, those discussions have been going on for quite a long time within the open education community, but they've not been taking place right across the educational community, and that's where they need to be. Those conversations need to be happening, and you've, as a practitioner, as an educator yourself, need to be thinking and getting to grips with those issues and making your own mind up. So, resource number three in the guidance documents is around finding openly licensed resources. And how do I actually locate? So I've had a look now at some of your licenses. I've got an idea about some of the icons and what that might look like. I might be able to just recognise something if I see it. But actually, what am I supposed to do? Trawl through the web looking for it and keeping my eyes open. That would be a bit tricky. So this document covers basic information about how to find and locate open educational resources. And there's a huge range of different ways of doing that, some of which are very mainstream, some of which are very specialist, some of which may be linked to your particular area of practice or interest as well. So what we did in the guidance documents is we also created a bunch of resources. And I've brought one that you can pass out and take one if you're interested in it, which is how to remix with Wikipedia text and images. So lots of us use Wikipedia. I know all of our students in Leicester use Wikipedia. Lots of our students go to the site. And I can see some scowling there, and we will address that scowling. But what you can do that you might not be aware of is there's a tool on Wikipedia that allows you to pick bits of text and images and create your own ebooks for learners from that. And so one of the things that we've done is we've created simple walkthroughs for people to show them actually it's quite easy to take and create and use and find content. So I'll just pass those around. If anybody wants one, please do take one. The other walkthrough that we've created looks at using Wikipedia, looks at using Flickr, which is an image sharing site that some of you might know, some of you may have an account on. What Wikipedia gives you the option to add a license to your work when you upload it, as many sites do, so YouTube as well, that gives you the option to upload. And there's a search within Flickr that very easily lets you select the kind of license that you're looking for and runs a keyword search according to that. And again, we've produced a very simple walkthrough for that. And one of the great things about that walkthrough is it's already been taken, used and adapted by a primary school computing teacher who's used it to create a series of lesson plans to teach kids how to find Flickr images, how to attribute them as part of the computing curriculum, because probably not everybody in this room is really familiar with the Key Stage 1 and 2 computing curriculum, but respect for other people's resources and respectful use of resources is part of that curriculum. Okay, so that's the walkthrough from the Flickr page, and that's the Wikipedia text image that you've had going around, and there's obviously you can just download those as well. The other kind of places that you can get images from that aren't the mainstream places, so we've talked about Wikipedia, we've talked about Flickr. There's also a search on Google. If you go to the advanced search tab on Google, you can find some things. There's also a CC search page that gathers together all different kinds of resources, so images, audio, video, text, and lets you just search. And there's an exciting notice gone up on that page recently that says Creative Commons are actually developing a new search facility, so that should be even better in the near future. But very simple, easy, mainstream ways to access resources. There's also, obviously, specialist repositories and information, and you might want to find out more about specific projects or what's going on, and there's a bunch of places that you can do that. I'm just going to head up a couple of them. So there's the OER Research Hub. They've recently created an OER impact map that shows globally the impact and benefits of using OER. So it's a really interesting piece of work to go and look at. This piece of work is surprisingly difficult to Google. I'm not sure why, but it's the PowerUp initiative that closed last year. And what this project has done is it's captured country by country OER initiatives and projects, but it also contextualises them with what the education system looks like in those countries, what things are going on in different sectors as well. So that's the United Kingdom page there, but there's some fascinating things going on all around the world. There's some really, really exciting projects in different countries. So if you're interested in a specific country, you can go and have a look and get some great information from there. Another thing that I'd obviously want to recommend is OER 15, which is going to take place in April in beautiful Cardiff, as if anybody needs an excuse to go to Cardiff for a couple of days. But that's going to be a national and international conference that gathers together people from all over the world that are interested in and involved in open educational resources. So it's a fantastic place to go to attend, to talk to people, to learn more and find out more. Okay, so the fourth set of resources that we've got is around openly licensing and sharing your resources. So how do I openly license and share? And there are two important checks that you need to make before you do this. So we've all had a look at what our favourite license is, and we've all thought, oh, if I'm going to share something, I think I'll share it with that license, because that license seems like a good idea to me. What are the things that we need to check before we apply that license to whatever our resource is? One, if you've produced the resource in the course of your employment, you will have to have your employer's permission. Okay? That's to do with copyright law and employment law. It's nothing to do with working in a university, working in local government, working in a school, working in any other sector. What happens is that within typical terms and contracts of employment, things that you create, the intellectual property belongs to your employer. If you create them within the context of your work, so if you're creating things for your work, sometimes people say with equipment that your work has given you, although that's a slightly more tenuous argument, I think. Those things, the intellectual property belongs to your employer in that case. So you need to know whether you can or can't openly license those things. And that stands for all sectors. Now, some people will have nothing in their terms and contracts of employment about this. Most people, especially in the university sector, will have something about this in there. But regardless of whether it's there or not, that's the legal position. So it's good to be aware of that so that you're safeguarding yourself as well in terms of your engagement. The other thing that you need to check is that have any materials you've used in your resource do you have permission to use those? So if I've created everything myself, then yes, that's an original resource. I don't need to worry about it. But if you add in other people's resources to create your resource, then you need to check that they're in the public domain, that they are openly licensed themselves and you're adhering to the conditions of that open license, or that you've got special permission because you've been around that person's house and they've given you a note to say, yes, help yourself. Okay, so what we've done at Leicester City Council is we've kind of looked at this issue in terms of employment and grappled with it. And what we did is we gave blanket permission to all of our school staff. So that's not all staff who work in schools, because some schools are managed and the legal employer is the governing body. So, for example, voluntary aided faith schools and academies and free schools, in their case, the employer is the governing body. But for community schools and voluntary controlled schools, Leicester City Council is the employer. So what we've done is we've given blanket permission to our school employees to release anything that they like under open license that's an educational resource. So they don't need to come and find somebody in the authority to ask about it. They don't need to worry that somebody's going to come back to them and say, you shouldn't have done this. We wanted to do something else with that resource. They still have to ask us if they want to, for example, if they want to sell the resources that they're creating in the terms of their employment, they still need to come and have a chat about that, because that's not what we've given blanket permission for. But if they want to release that under open license, then what we're saying is, please do go ahead. And there's a bunch of reasons that we've given that permission that are applicable to people that work in several sectors, not just in the school sector, I think. So one, it recognises current practice. People share, and that's a really, really positive, great thing. People share informally, and they do it all the time. So one of the things that we wanted to do by this was to recognise that they are sharing and that we want to support that. We want more sharing, not less sharing. We also want to try and support them in getting the recognition that they deserve and in making them less vulnerable in respect to the sharing practice that they currently do. Supporting digital literacy is a big thing for us. So I talked right at the beginning of this talk that we framed our work in this area in terms of what we believe are basic digital literacy practices and skills for people working in the employment sector. People working with digital resources need to understand basic copyright and open licensing issues. So this, for us, is a way of supporting their digital literacy and raising their skills and confidences in those areas. We want to empower our schools and staff insofar as possible, and what we believe is that the current copyright law restricts that. We don't think that they should need to come and ask special permission to openly license and share their excellent work. We think that they should be empowered to be able to go ahead and do that, rather than putting any barriers in their way with regard to that. Ensuring public value is obviously a huge thing. The work that we do is funded from the public purse. All of our work, my job, as well as the work of the school staff, is paid for by the public. And really what we would like to do is maximise the value that we get from that money and that resource. So if we've paid somebody to do some work, why don't we get more value and more benefit from that piece of work? Equality of access of learning to all is obviously key to us and at Leicester City Council, very, very dear to our hearts, as it is close to other people's hearts. Understanding and modelling copyright best practice is another issue for us, because obviously what we would like is staff that are standing at the front of the room or staff that are working online with learners to be modelling best professional practice. And if they're not aware of things like referencing, being able to use great images, looking at open licenses, then the practice that they may be modelling may not be great. It won't be as good as it could actually be. So it's a way of also supporting, by extension, learners, and supporting learners in understanding this aspect of digital literacy. And obviously supporting open and collaborative practice. We're very, very keen and passionate about teachers and other staff connecting locally, nationally, and internationally with other educators to develop and create, share and use resources. It's a very, very important part of all of our practice. We cannot do this on our own. None of us can do this on our own. We have to connect to other people. We have to respect the fact that other people are doing fantastic things that we can contribute to, and the fact that other people will bring great things to the work that we've done as well. Okay, so questions again for the audience. Who owns the intellectual property rights to the materials you produce? So employees. Anybody know who's an employee? Exactly right. So depending on what it says in your contract, if it does say anything, you will have some rights, or it will default down. Sorry, that's my fault. Hey.
But that also does depend on whether that's, I mean, they don't control the rights that you of stuff that you produce in your own time or in your own place. It's only relevant to your work and usually during your work time.
It is indeed. And, you know, one of the things that you can do is, for example, if you are thinking about something like writing a book or commercialising some of your work, the earlier you go and talk to the intellectual property team at your organisation, the better. Go and talk straight away to them and work up. Don't get to the risky position where you've signed a book deal and your employer turns around and goes, oh, hang on a minute. Have you asked anybody about this? You don't want to go there. Now, obviously, from our position, I would really support people in thinking about how they extend and support rights to openly licensed work. Either at institutional level or at the level of the individual. Who would you go and ask if you wanted to do that? Do people know that? People know who they would go and ask? Yeah, I mean, you've got an intellectual rights team working here, so you would go and ask. You could go and ask them, and you also have specific staff members assigned to that. Okay, students. Who owns students' work? Yeah. So the default legal position is that students own their own work because the laws as they relate to copyright are around employment and contracts of employment. So students in their own terms, like the students in Leicester, we explicitly comment in our work that we respect that they have ownership of their own intellectual property rights. And that's the default position. Now, what Coventry does and many, many other universities do in this country is that they require students to assign those rights to the university when they're undergraduates and or postgraduates. Obviously, there are conditions attached to some postgraduate work around the funding, so who's paying for your place, and have they attached any conditions relating to copyright on the work that you're producing as well. But at this university, the university that owns IPR on student work. And if students want to openly license work, they too would have to seek permission from the university to do that.
Is that on any student's work?
It's undergraduates, taught postgraduates and research postgraduates at this institution. Obviously, it varies from institution to institution. To do it on their own time, no, that's completely... So how Coventry deals with it, as many other universities, is that they've basically mirrored the conditions that staff have for students. So staff at this university particularly have a few exceptions around research outputs to their terms and conditions. Students basically are aligned with staff members, and that applies to all students, with the exception being if they have conditions within their funding that impacts on intellectual property. Okay, so moral rights. Does anybody know about moral rights? Anybody know what moral rights are? They sound great, don't they? I'd like to enjoy some moral rights. Okay, so moral rights is basically the right to be named as the creator of your work. OK, okay, the right for me to put on this piece of, on this document, along with Bjorn Hassler and Helen Neo, who worked with me on this document, our names. So we've got Leicester City Council on there, but we've also have our names on there. That's, again, it's not a right that's necessarily accorded to you if you're an employee or in a or if you've relinquished those rights. You don't necessarily have that right. So again, that's something to think about and to ask for as well. I think it's important that you have your name on those things if you want to. Obviously, sometimes people don't want to have their names on things. They want to have it, this is a university publication. But sometimes you do want to have your name on things. You don't automatically enjoy that right. So again, that's something for you to have a think about when you're going to be putting out work and sharing work. That's the open license for this presentation today. So please feel free to take this presentation, do it a lot better than we've done it today. We had a bit of a bump, I think, over the voting thing. I think everything else has gone reasonably well. But you, I'm sure people in this room could improve on it drastically. And thank you very much. And we've got a bit of time. We've got a bit of time for questions, haven't we?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
So thanks very much, Josie. So any questions?
Or I welcome just comments. If you don't have to ask me a question. You don't have to, if you've got something you want to say, you don't have to disguise it as a question in order to say it. You can just say it. I'm more than happy just to have contributions.
I still shouldn't say that, but okay. No, thanks, that was really interesting. I want to go back to you saying you work for a public institution and you kind of you think it's important that we all collaborate. So I'm wondering if Creative Commons is the best licensing system to use for that. For example, it's very individualistic. Everyone gets to choose their own individualistic license. Now, if, as a public institution, we think that everyone should be able to share this work, is there a case for a public institution having a set policy that says we own this, we're licensing this, and stopping people individually? Some people might be very generous. Some people might say, no, I don't want to share.
Yeah.
And so we could set as a policy, as a public institution, this is what we're actually going to do. So we wouldn't use Creative Commons at all.
I think absolutely is the answer to that. So how we've approached it is that we've made a recommendation to our schools. And our recommendation is based on the recommendation given by the British government and the recommendation from the European Commission in terms of the flexibility and freedom that licences should support within the public sector. Now, we've gone for Creative Commons rather than the Open Government Licence for a range of reasons. One of them being very pragmatic. Lots of educators already use Creative Commons. Creative Commons has an international presence, is a robust system. Lots of search engines are geared up to already find Creative Commons items. So it's an easier option in some ways. Also, one of the other things is I can't go around to everybody's house and talk to them about all of the licenses. They need to engage in these kind of things themselves. There's a huge wealth of brilliant resources for all ages explaining and talking about Creative Commons licenses. They've got comics, you know, they've got web pages, they've got all kinds of things that make it easier for people to engage with and find out information. So there's some of the reasons. I think your question as an organisation is a really valid one. So what we do is we've provided this recommendation and this blanket permission, but what we're seeing now is schools coming together as communities and deciding which licence they would prefer. And also, there may be some flexibility within licences at certain locations, because you may want to use one licence for some things and other licences for other things. Our preference and recommendation is to use the most flexible, most open license possible. But I think that's a community decision for organisations to engage with.
No, just a comment really about OER and in terms of finding out more about them. There's a very good JISC info kit on OER, which came out 3 years of a HEFCE funded program, which is full of resources, how to find them, how to evaluate them, all those kinds of things. And going back to the different types of licenses, there is a good case for using no derivatives you know, in certain contexts. So it may be that by changing a particular resource, you might make it unsafe, and people who can make changes to that resource may not know that. So, you know, I think it depends on the context and the resource.
Thanks ever so much for that comment. I think you're right, Jessica's done some amazing work in this area. And another thing that I would recommend that you have a look at is JISC Legal has actually wound up now. It's been brought into the main JISC family, but the JISC Legal website is still around, and they have really, really good resources around copyright and IPR for people in FE and HE that are really worth having a look at to find out kind of what the position is for you. It's a great resource, absolutely great resource. So thank you very much for that.
That was just a
you don't want to ask a question at all, do you?
I like the idea of having a single license for an entire institution, but I think I've worked on three repository projects now at three different universities, and you would not believe the incredible backlash you get when you suggest to most lecturers that they make their stuff freely available. I think you'd have to I was at an alt conference and I said there's only three genuine reasons why you shouldn't want to share your stuff. Either it's unfinished, it's stolen, or it's crap. And everybody in the audience agreed, but this was an e-learning community. And I think there's a big message you've got to send to people that, about the value of sharing and stuff before you could actually do anything like imposing OER on staff members. I think there's a whole negotiation and a marketing thing that needs to go on before you actually would start doing that. But I do like the idea of just having a single one.
Okay.
But you probably need to make it opt-in for a while, really, before...
Well, what we do is we've got a recommendation.
Yeah, okay.
And staff can choose that. But I recognise those issues very much. I think there are huge psychological issues with staff feeling vulnerable about putting their resources online. Because once you engage online, whether you're blogging, whether you're on Twitter, whether you're in any other kind of public online forum, you enter into an environment that's not always friendly, that sometimes is hostile. And, you know, we only have to look at things that have gone on online in the very recent future to know that for some people, they're more vulnerable than others in online situations. And very often the people that are most vulnerable in online situations are also the people that are quite vulnerable in offline situations. So there are issues around supporting people, there are issues around resilience, there are issues around having not the courage, but I think the community to be able to venture into those spaces for some people that are really, really serious and do really need addressing, that fall outside of kind of legal and other issues. And I think as communities we need to take very seriously how people are and feel and how comfortable they are within online environments in the same way that we care about how they are in our physical environments.
Okay, thank you, Josie. I've got this vision in my head now of you running around all over the world knocking on people's doors, going to their houses.
That's what I do when I'm not here.
So it was a really informative talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you ever so much for being so cooperative as well.